Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for tonight. You know, Wednesday night, and temperature's changing, and Louis just told me he caught a cold, so he can't be here. And Lord, I just pray that you would be with him and be with us, and be with anybody who's even on their way, and I just pray that you keep everybody safe. You know, it's not easy coming to the mountains, and but we know that when we come to church to study your word will refresh us. Your word will set our minds pointing to you. And we need to point to you, Lord. We need to look to you. So, Lord, be with us tonight. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. We are in 1 Samuel, and we're going to talk, going to be in chapter 15. And, just probably 15 and 16 today. And actually, this is, you know, this is the Lord really uses his word to help us understand life. And sometimes we just, you know, we kind of take it for granted that we kind of know everything. And for people who's been in church for a while, you know, like I've been in church, I mean, my dad's a pastor, and I mean, when I was born, I was born into a pastor's family, right? But being a PK, it makes, you know what a PK is? Pastor kid, usually bad. Yeah, and usually very bad. And so, I mean, I was just a rebellious kid. A lot of you guys probably don't know, I think I mentioned this, I used to have hair all the way down, as long as yours, like here. I used to have hair all the way down here. So very, you know, rebellious kid, and then I had a perm. It was like this, so just a weird time. But anyway, God's word teaches us about life, and He will always, and it's amazing how His plan is, because, you know, in the end, she, in kind of retirement, He brought me back here. So it's pretty, you know, he just has his plan. And the key thing about tonight is that when God speaks, when God tells us to do stuff, we should follow it. Because, you know, every time if we don't follow it, you know, as I mentioned before, that we would go sideways. He will allow us to go sideways, but again, those are just a tough road, and it's just rough. But looking back at those rough roads, every single time God would always tell me what I should do, and I could still remember not telling, basically just by not doing it, and not doing it, it's just telling God no, that I know better. And those are always the rough road, and we're going to see this today. All right, chapter 15, verse 1. Samuel also said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord." You know, Saul, you know, you remember he just kind of blew it. He tried to become, he tried to do Samuel's work. Because Samuel was late in chapter 13, and he tried to do priestly work, and kings weren't supposed to do that, and he wasn't a Levite, and he was doing somebody else's work, Levitical work, and the Lord didn't call him to do that, and he did it. He disobeyed the Lord, and Samuel's here in chapter 15 is saying that, you know, the Lord anointed you to be king, and then heed, listen to the voice of the word of God. And I think, as I said, we should always do that. Listen to the word of God and his instructions. Verse 2, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel. Now he ambushed him on the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have, and do not spare them. but kill both man, woman, infant, and nursing child, ox, and sheep, camel, and donkey. Whoa, that's kind of rough. Amalek, do you guys remember when the Israelites came out of Egypt, the first group that attacked them was the Amalekites. And the Amalekites, they played dirty. These guys were very evil and very cruel. And they even, used infants for worship by killing infants. I mean, just cruel stuff, very bad. They attacked the Israelites from the back, meaning that the Israelites were coming out of Egypt, and the back had the elderly, the older people, the people who can't walk as fast, the sick, and basically they attacked the weakest point, weakest part. And the Lord did tell them that when you guys settle into the land, I'm going to have you go take care of these guys, right? And now is the time. God, through Samuel, is telling them that, it's time to take care of these guys because they attacked, you. And the Lord says to utterly wipe these guys out, including everybody and all the animals. Why would God say that? I mean, it's everyone? And do you guys remember, we kind of studied this before, that there are times that, why God would do anything like that, we don't really know, but if God said it, there must be a reason. And sometimes I think about this, I say, God uses, and we mentioned this before, human instruments for judgment. There are times God does that. Because these guys, these Amalekites, they were terrible people. And it's almost like they were on that path to just self-destructing too. In the end, they would have been destroyed by themselves. But if they were to mingle with other groups, then it's going to come back to bite the other group. And that means if Israelites were to mingle with them, then it's going to come and hurt the Israelites. And we're going to see what happened. So God uses other people or the Israelites to do his work as human instruments. And sometimes God will use other people to come to me and say, hey, Pastor John, you need to watch this and watch that and just kind of remind me things. And I'm okay with that. If it's really from the Lord, unless they're just making things up, then I'm not okay with that. I would correct them. But with that said, I think that's why the Lord said, you need to utterly wipe these guys out. So verse 4. So Saul gathered the people together and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, these Kenites were friendly to Israel, but they lived very close to the Amalekites. And so he told them, go, depart, get down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. So he warned them to get out of there. So Saul, just want to make sure that people who are friendly to the Israelites, you get a chance. You have a chance to go out. And then, so the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. Verse 7, and Saul attacked the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, which is east of Egypt. He also took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. What did God tell him to do? Alive and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But, when you hear a but, then we got to pay attention, right? Saul and the people spared fatlings, the lambs, and all that was good, and were unwilling to utterly destroy them, but everything despised and worthless that they utterly destroyed. Wow. Totally disregarded what God told him to do. Sometimes, and as I said, Samuel told him to take heed of the voice of God, take heed to God's instructions. And this guy just ignored it, just did part of it. Verse 10, now the word of the Lord came to Samuel saying, I greatly regret that I have set up Saul as king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel, and he cried out to the Lord all night. Wow. There's a couple things here. First of all, Saul didn't do what God told him to do. That's a problem, right? But then, you know, the word of God here says, God is talking to Samuel, said, I greatly regret. That word regret, that means God changed his mind. Turn to verse 29 here, on the same chapter, verse 29, and then it's, and also the strength of Israel, that's God, will not lie nor relent, for he is not a man that he should relent. And relent, meaning that he's not going to regret anything, he's not going to change his mind. And then we also learn from Numbers, and I wrote it down somewhere here. It's going to be Numbers 23, I believe. Maybe I didn't write it down. But Numbers 23, oh, I did, I put it here. 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, nor son of man that he should repent. Has he said, and will he not do? Or has he not spoken, and will he not make it good? So God is eternal. And God, he is what we call immutable. That means he doesn't change. Because he's eternal, he sees everything, and he's forever. He doesn't change. But why does he say, I greatly regret? So we have to realize that we're translating using human language, human words, into what's in the heart of God, his word. And so sometimes we can't catch that point. God rejected, Saul or something, but he didn't change his mind. He didn't regret. I mean, he basically, the word that we can use here is regret. But sometimes, it kind of makes us think that, oh, God changed his mind. He thought this, and then later he thought it was wrong. No, God is never wrong. He's eternal. He sees everything. He's immutable. He doesn't change. So I just want to point this out. It's not a mischaracterization. It's not something that, oh, the Bible is wrong. It says one thing there. No, it's just a human translation, human words. Sometimes God's thoughts are higher than ours, his ways are higher than ours, and there are words that are just not invented yet to totally describe the Lord. Okay, and then, so what happened was, God said, hey, this guy is not listening to me. And so it grieved Samuel too. And I like the fact that I think about Samuel. Samuel's really old right now. And he's about to just pass the torch. And he's the one who anointed Saul. So Saul was kind of like a protege. He anointed him. But then he's not doing his work. And he's not following the Lord. And it grieved him all night. And the love that Samuel had for Saul, that was nice. That's really good. Because I believe if a shepherd, anybody who's in mission, in church work, that person should love the Lord and love the people, love the sheep. And I look at this, it says, and it grieved Samuel, and he cried out to the Lord all night. And I'm going, wow, he has a shepherd's heart too. All right, and then verse 12, so when Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, he was told Samuel, saying, Saul went to Carmel, and indeed he set up a monument for himself and he has gone on around, passed by, and gone to Gilgal. Then Samuel went to Saul, and Saul said to him, Blessed are you of the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. Big fat lie. A big fat lie. You know, this is, there are people who only hears what they want to hear. And when they, what they want to hear, and they just want to do what they want, they heard, and they don't want to, and if they don't agree with it, they don't want to do that part, they don't agree with it, right? But their response to all this, they know they didn't do everything, but they're going to cover it up with spiritual words, with churchy words. Blessed are you of the Lord. They're gonna do that. And then I have performed the commandment of the Lord. My pastor told a story once that he in the Mount of Olives, if you go to Israel, and I think all of you one day should go to Israel. There is a guy who's one of the famous pickpockets. And what he does is when he sees people, and usually Christians come, he would go, praise the Lord, blessed are you. And then he would just hug the people. And next thing, what happens is your stuff's gone. And he praises the Lord and blesses the Lord because he's got good stuff, right? And just because people use, you know, words, churchy words and Bible words, spiritual words, doesn't mean that they love the Lord. And so be careful with that. And the Saul was just doing that. And then verse 14, look at what Samuel said. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears? You know, all the noise and the lowing of the oxen which I hear. And Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, they, his people, right? They have brought them, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. So they, you know, they have brought all the good stuff out, and we're going to use them as sacrifice. But did God, was that his instruction? No. This guy was just, and the thing was this, he got caught. He got caught. Instead of saying that, I'm sorry, I did wrong. Instead of repenting, he doubled down. He used more Christian words or churchy words or Bible words. He used more. Hey, we're going to use these, the best from and sacrifice to your God. We're going to do that as if he was doing Samuel a favor, doing God a favor. But what Saul didn't realize was Saul didn't know God's word. Because if he knew the law of the Lord, back in Deuteronomy, there's a section where it talks about never not to use any animals that are from pagan countries to sacrifice to God. He didn't know God's word, but he was trying to use God's word. And he was trying to use God's word to cover up. Instead of just saying, man, I'm so sorry. I blew it. And asking God to forgive him, he didn't. He didn't even repent. He just tried to double down. And today it happens today. People try to use Bible words, verses. I mean, I get them all the time. And they just say, oh, you need to. And I'm going, you know, we'll pray. We'll just pray. Because if they use Bible words and they use verses, try to do something, and I know what is going on, then we just pray. We pray for them and allow the Lord to take care of it, right? Okay. And Saul said, verse 16, Then Samuel said to Saul, "Be quiet." Whoa. Shut up. That's what Samuel said, right? "And I will tell you what the Lord said to me last night." Oh my goodness. And then he said to him, Saul said to Samuel, "Speak on." So Samuel said, "When you were little in your own eyes," that means when you're humble, "were you not the head of the tribes of Israel? And did not the Lord anoint you king over Israel? Now the Lord sent you on a mission and said, 'Go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are consumed.' Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and do evil in the sight of the Lord?" Wow. You know, when Saul, he started out really well. He was a humble guy. And he was just, you know, humble and scared. But now he thinks he's hot stuff. And now he just, they saw all the nice, juicy animals. And they said, "Man, this is utterly destroying these. That's a waste of money. And we could do this, you know, the church could use this. Or we could use this instead of our own." I mean, all sorts of excuses, right? And then Samuel said, verse 20, and Saul said to Samuel, "But I have obeyed the voice of the Lord." See, he didn't even back down. "But I have obeyed and gone on mission on which the Lord sent me and brought back Agag, king of Amalek." Wow. That's another lie. God told him to destroy everybody. But then he brought back the king of Amalek. Why did he do that? Maybe to get more stuff. "I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites." He didn't utterly destroy the Amalekites. You know why I know that? Because we're going to read, you know, a few more chapters, David's going to have to fight some Amalekites. And then even after David, so that means there's somebody left. And there's Amalekites that are fighting. And then after David, if we go to the book of Esther, Esther is right after this. In the time of Esther, there's a guy named Haman. Haman was a descendant of, he's part of the Agagites. Agagites are Amalekites, but they're a different name, meaning that the king is Agag, right? Agag actually is a title for all the kings of the Amalekites. And so Haman was one of the descendants of Agag. So Haman, do you know what Haman tried to do? Most of you know this. Haman tried to destroy all of the Jews. Tried to destroy all of the Jews. And then he almost did. And the Lord had to use Esther to, you know, to get the king, her husband, to send out another command saying the Israelites could defend themselves. Because what this Haman did was, if you destroy any of the Israelites, you get to keep all the spoils, all the land, everything they have. It was evil. And so this whole thing, and I look at this, Amalek in the Bible, actually it describes as a type of the flesh. And we know as Christians, we have the Spirit of the Lord in us. And the Spirit is always in battle with the flesh. I mean, it's always. Until we meet the Lord and when we're in heaven, that stops. But even now, there's always that battle going on. And the Bible tells us to put to death the flesh, to mortify the flesh. 1 Peter 3, somewhere there, it tells us to mortify the flesh. Because if you don't mortify the flesh, the flesh is going to come and basically it's a battle all the time. And it's almost like a battle to the death. Because every day we're still in this mortal body, even though you know the Lord, I know the Lord, we're still sinners. Because the flesh is trying to get us all the time. And what the Lord is telling these guys, you know, Saul, get rid of this. But he didn't do it. And now, and then later on, David's going to have to fight. And now, and then Esther, all these guys, because Haman still survived. And then the Jews almost got wiped out because this guy, Saul, didn't listen. We got to think about the consequences of not listening to the Lord and how that affects everyone. And I think about the flesh. This Sunday, actually, we're starting Leviticus. I'm very excited about that. I know you guys are very excited about it, but I don't know if anybody's really know about Leviticus now, because I want to say this, because if I were to ask you to rank your top 60 top books of the Bible, I don't think anybody would rank Leviticus number one, right? You guys probably put it on the bottom five or something like that. But actually, it should be on top. And then this Sunday, we're going to talk about how the Lord is holy and how we're sinful. And it relates to this too. The spirit and the flesh are always in battle. And then this Sunday, actually, it worked out that the Filipino Bible study, we're talking about Romans 7 and talks about sinful nature and how, and actually it relates to today's too. So I was looking at all three today and I was going, man, Lord, this wasn't planned. This was not planned, but how you put everything together that, so in the next few Bible studies and including the Sunday's sermon, you're going to get, everything's going to really tie together. So it's kind of cool how God did that. But if you think about it, if we don't understand that there's this battle going on and how we need to walk with the Lord, how we need to protect ourselves through the reading of scriptures, through fellowship, through Bible study, the flesh, I've seen the flesh destroy many families. I've seen the flesh destroy many marriages and how the flesh destroys many children's relationship with parents. I mean, it's just terrible. And so we really need to understand that there's this battle, and then how should we be equipped? And number one, and from today, is to heed the voice of the Lord. Listen to God. What he tells you, pay attention. That little voice telling you to, when you're trying to go sideways, and that voice inside you is telling you to don't do it, that's from the Lord. That's the Holy Spirit telling you, don't do it. Hurry up, turn around, don't do it. Go to the Lord, seek after the Lord. A lot, yeah, anyway, I got to get going, because if I keep going, I'll never get done. All right, then, He told him to be quiet, and then he basically said, the Lord told you to do it, and you didn't do it. And then, but Saul said to Samuel, but I have obeyed, and these oxen and sheep are for the to be sacrificed. But then Samuel said, verse 22, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offering and sacrifice as in obeying the voice of the Lord? You know, he's saying that, you know, is God pleased with just these burnt offering, or is God more pleased with you obeying his word? And you see, God sees the heart of all of us. He sees our heart. And Romans 7, which is for the Filipino Bible, it's about the law is spiritual, right? It's spiritual. And God sees the heart. It's not what we do, because a lot of people try to do it to cover up their sins and do things, and, oh, I'm going to spend more time. time in the church and, you know, do things for the church. But God sees the heart. God sees the heart. And then, and he said, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey is better as to heed than the fat of rams. Means to listen and do than to offer the fat of rams, to offer sacrifice. And then verse 23, this is what gets me, is for rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft. To rebel, not listen, I mean, that's all evil spiritual stuff. And stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Stubbornness. The Lord's been telling me, telling you, and, you know, to do this, do that, and we just totally ignore it. The Lord, sometimes just, he's so patient, he's telling us, and we keep ignoring it. And what happens, the result is our heart gets harder. It gets hardened. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king. Wow. I would never want to hear anything that tells me God has rejected you for anything. We don't want to hear that. Saul, the king, just heard that. He has rejected you as king. So sad. And remember, he had such potential. Verse 24, then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voices. You know, he finally confessed, but people can debate on this, but it's kind of a not a really good confession, because he knew he got caught, he blew it, and he came up with all his excuses, and Samuel just slammed him. And he said he sinned, but he said, well, I fear the people. What about fearing God? What about, I mean, today I was going through all these, and I was going, wow, Lord. It's one of those days that I was struggling with a lot of things, with life, with people, with just different things. I would just, it's a struggle, and then it's very, very hard sometimes. But then the Lord reminded me that God is there, that He is there, that He is there, and then so. He confessed, but I think it's kind of a veiled confession. Verse 25, now therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may worship the Lord. But Samuel said to Saul, I will not return with you, for you have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you from being king over Israel. And Samuel turned around to go away. Saul seized the edge of his robe, and it tore. So Samuel said to him, the Lord has turned the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to a neighbor of yours who is better than you. And also the strength of Israel will not lie nor relent, for he is not a man that he should relent. Wow. Saul was so desperate that he grabbed Samuel, and Samuel's clothes torn, and then so it signified that Saul is not going to be king anymore. Sad for Saul. Then, verse 30. Then he said, I have sinned. Yet honor me now, please, before the elders of my people and before Israel, and return with me that I may worship the Lord your God. So Samuel returned back and after Saul, and Saul worshiped the Lord. You know, Samuel has a soft heart, because Samuel was the one who anointed Saul, and Samuel cried all night long for Saul, and so he did turn back. And then but Samuel said this, and listen to this, verse 32. Then Samuel said, bring Agag, king of the Amalekites, here to me. So Agag came to him cautiously. So Agag, he's scared, right? And Agag said, surely the bitterness of death is past. So Agag is thinking that, let bygones be bygone, right? But Samuel said, verse 33, as your sword has made women childless, so shall your mother be childless among women. And Samuel hacked Agag in pieces before the Lord in Gilgal. This is, back then, being a prophet, you got to be tough. You're not afraid. And you're not afraid of just doing bloody stuff. And if you think about it, all the Levites, Sunday we're going to find out, they had to do a lot of the sacrifices, right? And the temple actually was very bloody. So, but we're going to find out why. And then, so Agag is no longer around. He's in pieces. Verse 34, then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in Gibeah of Saul, and Samuel went no more to see Saul until the day of his death. You know, there's actually one more time that Samuel did see Saul. It was during a kind of a seance, it's kind of a weird thing going on. So when we get there, we're going to talk about it. Nevertheless, Samuel mourned for Saul, and the Lord regretted, again, using that word, you know, that's just the word that, you know, human word to represent what God's meaning, that he had made Saul king over Israel. God just rejected Saul. We're going to go over this chapter really quick. Now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing that I have rejected him and from reigning over Israel? But I really like Samuel because I love his heart. His heart, he has a really soft heart for people and a soft heart for Saul. But then Samuel can also be tough too, as he hacked Agag. When he sees that, he just, you know, bloodied him. He cut him to pieces. But then the Lord told him, fill your horn with oil and go. I am sending you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a king among his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hears it, he'll kill me. But the Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. And then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I name to you. Wow. So this is a little tricky. Samuel was tough, but then, you know, prophets, and I will say pastors, we are all human beings. We're not God. We're human beings, but we're under higher, stricter judgment than everybody else. The reason is we're imparting God's word. And if we're saying anything that's wrong or anything that doesn't represent the Lord, God will deal with us too. But we're human beings. We get angry. We get scared. We're sinners. So don't look at prophets or back then or today. Don't look at pastors or leaders as, you know, as God, because we're not. We're just people. Every single pastor should be pointing to anybody looking over here, we should be pointing to the Lord. Always point to the Lord. And if someone tells you guys, if they say, oh, you're such a good Sunday school teacher, if you're such a good this, good that, wow, you're serving the Lord, point them to the Lord. Just say thank you and praise God, and God's doing all this. We give glory and honor to God, never to ourselves. So that's why it's, you know, when someone says, oh, I have people that come in right away, I said, oh, I'm your next Bible study teacher, or I'm your next Sunday school teacher, or I'm your next this and that, because I have all, you know, and I look at them, I say, you know, first of all, I need to get to know you first, right? I need to get to know you. And then, and as usually what I do is, from the word of God, is if someone's doing something and they have a heart to serve and they're kind of doing it already, helping out, doing this? And then yes, of course. Then it's just natural. But I had like almost the first year I was here, I had a guy that came in here and tell me that, oh, I did this, did that, and I can do this. And he expected me to appoint him right away. Second week he's gone. Because I told him that, you know, I got to get to know you, and we got to get to know each other. And I don't even know your theology and all that. Oh, I'm this and that. But anyway, this, you know, the Lord, prophets and pastors are human beings. And Samuel, he was scared. He said, Saul's got a temperament. You know, he suddenly gets really mad. And he says, oh, kill that guy. He's king. And Samuel doesn't want to get killed, right? He said, I'm going to go anoint someone else to be king. And while he's still king, I mean, what are you doing, Lord? And Samuel didn't want to do that. And so the Lord told him, hey, take a sacrifice with you and just invite Jesse. Say, we're coming here to sacrifice. All truth. So if you guys ever got stuck in how to talk to someone when you're scared, you ask the Lord. You go talk to the Lord and ask the Lord to tell you what to do. And then let him open that door or shut that door and let him do it. He'll tell you what to do. And if you do it, and everything he said was true. God told him to do this, and he got a heifer, and he's going to go talk to Jesse and said, let's go sacrifice. But this gets a little tricky. But it's not everything, right? Because he's supposed to be going to anoint the king. It's not everything. So I was debating all afternoon while I was running whether to share this section or not, because it took me a long time to get it. And it's not that easy, but I'm going to try. So what happens if you just, if you say something and you know that, you know, there's that whole big truth out there, and you offended someone, but they didn't know anything about it, right? They didn't know anything about it, but you do. There are people that would say that, you know, I need to just blurt everything out. But when you blurt everything out, and this is, you're going to have to ask the Lord yourself. I'm just going to give you some, you know, what I see from here and what I've learned from my pastor is that when you blurt everything out, sometimes blurting everything out hurts more than the actual sin. Sometimes. And let's just say a husband and wife relationship, right? And this gets tricky because I'm a family counselor too. But if we just say everything that's came to our mind, everything that comes to our mind when we're angry, when we're mad, everything to each other, as a family, as a pastor, family counselor, there's not going to be any more marriages out there. Because if you say everything that comes to your mind, meaning that I'm going to kill you, or I'm going to just stab you 10 million times every day, I'm going to do this and everything. So this gets tricky, I know, because pastor, you're telling me to not say anything. No, you need to go talk to the Lord yourself. But I'm saying in this section here, I see it here. They're going to anoint, but the Lord told him to take a heifer and do all this other stuff, right? But the, so, and what about friends in church? If you say everything that comes across your mind to that person, everything, you're not going to have a friend anymore. You're not. So the Lord, what Samuel did was he did not lie. And he talked to the Lord. So my encouragement is, whenever you're stuck about anything, you talk to the Lord first. Have him guide you first. But sometimes if you blurt just stuff out, sometimes the tongue, our human tongue, can hurt. It causes more damage than good. And we got to be very careful of that, to use wisdom in that. It's tough because it took me a long time to just think this through. But you're going to have to deal with it on your own with the Lord. But my takeaway is ask God what you should do, right? But think about it. These are deep theological kind of real life stuff that you're going to have to deal with and kind of wrestle with the Lord about it. All right. So I'm going to close up here. So Samuel did what the Lord said and went to Bethlehem, and the elders of the town trembled at his coming and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, verse 5, "Peaceably, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. So it was, when they came, that he looked at Eliab and said, "Surely the Lord is anointed is before him." So Samuel, even though he's a really cool prophet, he still uses human eyes. So again, prophets, pastors, human beings, we make mistakes too. So don't just be careful, because I don't want anyone to think, and there are people just look at certain pastors like, "Oh, not good." Point to the Lord. We need to follow God. And then, so Samuel was thinking that, you know, this guy must be it because he's good looking, he's all that. It must be him. But the Lord said, no. So verse 7, "But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature." So he must have been good looking and tall, "because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. So Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. And Samuel said to Jesse, are all the young men here? Then he said, there remains yet the youngest, and there he is, keeping the sheep." Man, David his dad, Jesse, didn't even think about asking David to come. That's how much he thought about David. He's just taking care of the sheep, right? But then, and Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down till he comes here." So he sent and brought him in, and he was ruddy. Ruddy in the Hebrew means red hair. So David has red hair, with bright eyes and good looking or good countenance. Actually, in the Hebrew, that means he has beautiful eyes, a good face, beautiful eyes. So he can ruddy, fair complexion, beautiful eyes, right? And then the Lord said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went to Ramah. Think about it. David's just a young kid, very young, a young kid, but he was a war. I mean, when we get to David, I mean, he was, and we'll find out right away. But can you imagine him, this youngest, and then Samuel just kind of poured this oil over him and dripped down and anointed him, and while everybody, his whole family was watching, probably jealous and was going, whoa, what's going on, right? And the Spirit of the Lord came upon that epi. It's not the para. You remember the Spirit, God's Spirit is, he's with you, trying to help us to get to know him before we become Christians. Once we become a Christian, he's in you, on, E-N, in you, and this upon is the power, the dunamis power of the Lord, using the Spirit of the Lord. And this, the same word, is came upon David from that day forward. Very cool. And then, this is a kind of a tough part. We're going to finish up here in the last few minutes. But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. So the Spirit of the Lord came upon David. The next verse is the Spirit of the Lord departed Saul. We never want to hear that. Never want to hear that. And a distressing spirit from the Lord troubled him. Wow, what does that mean? Distressing spirit, an evil spirit, came, spirit from the Lord troubled him. This is a tough section. How can that happen? So, nobody knows. I mean, it's in the Bible. Nobody really knows what this means, but because God can do whatever he wants. And if God's word says it, you know, it means there's got to be a reason for it. So here's something to think about. One is that a person, God has some sort of protection on God's people. We see that in Job. Because you remember Satan was saying, yeah, you know, you're protecting Job. If you take your protection off and let me get at him. And God allowed Satan. And so God took that protection away from Job, allowed Satan to go after Job, right? And that's because and that's because God was bragging about Job. And one thing is, we asked the Lord, said, Lord, we want to walk with you, but don't brag about us because we don't want to go through what Job did, right? So God was bragging about Job, and this is what that's what happened to him. But with that said, when we get to Job, we're going to find out. But God took that protection away and allowed Job, Satan to go after, and go after Job with certain parameters. That could be what happened. But then the other thing to think about is, and this is just, these are all deep theological things, and that people across the street and in the Baptist seminaries and all these places, they tackle, and even my own seminary back in the States. The other thing is this, is that maybe it's that Satan, who do you think Satan's, and I asked this before, I want to see if you guys remember, what's the opposite of Satan? Some people say, oh, it's God. It's not God, because God's God. Satan is a fallen angel. So opposite of Satan is just another angel. It's maybe Michael, Gabriel, someone like this, some, you know, an angel like that. Because Satan was in Lucifer, archangel, and people call him the choir director of heaven, but he fell. And so opposite of Satan is not God. A lot of people think opposite of Satan is God. It's not. God is only one God. He has no opposites. So with that said, since God is omnipotent, you know, God sees everything, he gives us the freedom to choose to accept him or not to accept him. And then, but he sees everything, so he, in the end, he knows. So he has his sovereign plan, but there's that dimension where we still have a choice to accept or not to accept, and that's what Adam and Eve did. And he allows Satan, I mean, he's God, Satan's not God. So he allows Satan to do what he can do with certain limitations because he's not God. So this distressing spirit is basically part of the purpose of God. And that's something to kind of ponder too. These are all theological questions to think about. But for me, both sides, both answers is God took the protection off and just allow Satan to do what needs to be done within the parameters, just like Job, or we can see it as God is omnipotent, and then he allows certain things to happen, including having this happen. So anyway, there are two things that I wasn't sure if I wanted to talk about, but I talked about it. So the Lord did it. Verse 15, and Saul's servant said to him, surely a distressing spirit from God is troubling you. Let our master now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is a skillful player of the harp, and it shall be that he will play it with his hand when the distressing spirit from God is upon you, and he shall be well. So Saul said to his servants, provide me now a man who can play well and bring him to me. And then one of the servants answered and said, look, I have seen a son of Jesse the Bethlehemite who is skillful in playing, a mighty man of valor, a man of war, prudent in speech, and a handsome person, and the Lord was with him. Wow. So David was just a young boy, but he has a reputation. And if you remember, later on, we're going to find out David, basically, he's good looking. I mean, this is all descriptions of him. A man of war actually is a man of valor. He's a vigilant man, and he's not afraid, a brave guy. And we know he killed a bear and a lion, and who was trying to get his lambs, and of course he killed Goliath, right? So moving forward, we're going to be going over all that. So he was very brave, but he was a harpist. He was very musically talented. In fact, when we get to the Psalms, Lord willing, this guy's musical, very musical, and he loves to dance too. So I think that's kind of cool. Verse 19, therefore Saul sent messengers to Jesse and said, send me your son David, who is with the sheep. And Jesse took a donkey loaded with bread, a skin of wine, and a young goat, and sent them by his son David to Saul. So David came to Saul and stood before him. And he, that's David, loved him greatly, and he became his armor bearer. So very cool. David, I mean, he had the Spirit of the Lord with him. He loved Saul and became his armor bearer. And I'm thinking that David, you know, just a kid who was a shepherd boy, going to be the future king. This is the start of the relationship here. And he loved Saul, and it showed, because when Saul was trying to kill him, David had the highest respect for Saul, even though Saul was trying to kill him, because he had the highest respect for God's anointed. It means when God's chosen someone to be king, you respect that person. He wouldn't allow his men to kill Saul even when they had a chance to kill Saul. And this is where it started. David had loved greatly, had a deep love for Saul, and he showed it in his life. And let's see. And then Saul sent to Jesse saying, please let David stand before me, for he has found favor in my sight. And so it was, whenever the Spirit of God was upon Saul, that David would take a harp and play it with his hand. Then Saul would become refreshed as well, and the distressing spirit would depart from him. Wow. Takeaway is this. David, in the end, he actually did a lot worse than what Saul did. He actually committed sins worse than Saul ever did. But the difference was that when confronted with his sin, David didn't make any excuses. He confessed his sin. He repented. He said, you remember, he said, create in me a clean heart, O God. And he asked God to change him, to transform him. And that's what we need. Jesus said to repent and believe, and David totally changed. sometimes that one big one, it took him a year, but he changed. He asked the Lord to change him and create in him a clean heart. Saul didn't do that. Saul just made excuses. And he tried to double down with spiritual words, but he did not fool God. And for you and me today, when God tells us to do something, and that still small voice in us, we need to do it. We shouldn't wait. And sometimes, you know, man, I just want to do my own thing. I just want to go for it and spill my, you know, everything in my mind and just let this guy have it. Don't do it. It hurts. It hurts more than it helps. And so, yeah, let's just ask the Lord whenever we're in doubt and ask him to guide us and then listen to him, right? Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you for being our God and being so gracious, so patient with us. Lord, may you just be with each one here as they live life. And I know everyone has their own issues, but Lord, will you guide them, Lord? And if there's any questions on what to do, will you just make it clear to them and allow them and let them know that you are there with them and guide them each step of the way. Take each one home safely, Lord, and until we meet again, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thanks for coming, guys.